हाईवे ये है रोशनी का कारवां।
Hi and welcome to Highway Conversations. My name is George Abraham, and today my guest is Dr. Meghna Verma, who began life as an ophthalmologist, but today is a mental health professional. Welcome, Meghna. And my first question to you is, how come the switch from being an ophthalmologist to a mental health professional?
So thank you, George. Thank you for having me here. And also thank you for helping me make this transition. So you were very instrumental in helping me make this transition. I was working as an ophthalmologist and in one of the premier institutes of this country, and suffering with a degenerative eye condition, retinitis pigmentosa. I suffer from retinitis pigmentosa. I always had this knowledge that my vision is gradually deteriorating, and there would be a day when I would have to quit ophthalmology completely.
Right.
When my employers came to know about this, about my eye condition, which I disclosed myself to them.
Yes.
And that time I was in clinical practice. So I was doing my surgeries, I was doing my OPD. And when my eye condition was detected, I disclosed it to them myself. I think they themselves did not know how to react to it or where to put me. Probably I might be the only unique case they have ever come across, me being an ophthalmologist and suffering from an eye disease.
Right.
So so they figured out that one way to retain me would be to put me in a non-clinical side. So they had put me in the administrative side of the hospital.
Yes.
Which was fine. And to their credit, they encouraged me to do an MBA also. So I did an MBA from ISB and went back to the hospital to take up an administrative role. But I really used to miss the clinical side, because clinical side really involves a lot of, you know, dealing with patients, seeing people, interacting with them. And that was the skill that I had worked for the last 10, 12 years of my life. So switching to an administrative side was somehow, it was very dissatisfying. And I was looking out to do something clinical.
Yes.
When I put forward my request to my employers that, okay, maybe not really clinical role, maybe a paraclinical or a research role would be good for me. I would be more satisfied in a research role. But somehow it didn't go down well, or they didn't pay attention to it, or whatever. For like 2-3 years, I just kept on waiting for that to happen. But
so basically, you wanted to do something which was still linked with the eye and people.
Absolutely, because I had worked in this field for almost 10 years by then.
Right.
And it was dear to me. It was not that I didn't enjoy my profession. I completely enjoyed the scientific and the clinical side of it. So I was really missing it, and I figured out that research might be a good way to have a connection with my ophthalmology. Whatever I have read, like 6 years of MBBS, 3 years of MS, and 1 year of fellowship, which means 10 years to become a specialist. And then after that, I was in practice for 3 years.
So by the way, where did you do your medicine and your specialization in MS in ophthalmology from?
So I'm from Mumbai. I'm basically from Mumbai. And my MBBS was from KEM Hospital in Mumbai. And MS was from JJ Hospital in Mumbai.
Right.
And fellowship was in cornea, which is a super specialty, and it was from LB Prasad in Hyderabad.
Hyderabad, okay.
Yes. So, but then when I could not find an avenue or a sympathetic, or rather I should say an empathetic employer, like who would still find value in my in all the education that I had, and probably give me a role which fit me, which I thought would fit me better. So I was kind of trying to approach a lot of people and try to put forward my case. In fact, whenever I would approach people also, a lot of people would advise me not to make it apparent on the CV itself or tell the would-be employers about my eye condition. But I used to be... I used to think that no, there is no point in hiding it. And over a period of time, because I would get this advice from everybody around me, from friends and relatives, over a period of time, it slowly, somehow subconsciously, I was kind of ashamed of it.
Yeah, in fact, it's human tendency to hide weaknesses, isn't it?
Yes, and it was, though unintentional, everybody, my bosses, my colleagues, my friends, everybody would try to kind of maybe with good intention itself, but they would try and advise me not to make it evident to people that I have this.
And little do they realize that if they discover, it could be quite a disaster, isn't it?
Absolutely. So and over a period of time, I started becoming very ashamed of it. So, I would actually think of it as a weakness. Like, you know, I am a lesser person, probably like a lesser human being or something, a lesser doctor, a lesser everything.
I think this was around the time that we bumped into each other.
Absolutely. So, I think when I met you, I spoke to you like the entire day, but I had not told you that I have a condition myself.
Right.
That I have. So I can still see, even today, I have partial vision.
Right.
But it is, it's not good enough for me to be independent, like at least to move around independently. Mobility.
Definitely not good enough to cut somebody's eye and remove the cornea.
Definitely not. Definitely not.
Right.
Yeah. So, so then when we bumped into each other, I and the first thing that really struck me was that you were so independent. Like, you hailed your own taxi, you came to the hospital all alone. And then I asked you, is there anybody with you? I think then you said, no, I travel all over the world alone. And I was like, wow, that's something. And then I thought that I should tell you. And then I told you about this. And then...
I remember that car ride from the hospital to your house. Yes, I remember that. Yeah.
Yes. So then I told you that, I feel that I should still continue in some way as a doctor. And otherwise, all those years of study, I don't feel I'm justifying it.
That's right.
Yeah, in my current role, and I feel highly dissatisfied and all that. And then you told me examples of these doctors who lost their vision while they were in service, and they still continued to be doctors.
Right.
So, so you gave me those examples, and then suddenly it was like, I had never thought of it. Like, it's possible to do that. Till then, everybody around me, be it my employer, be it my own parents and or my husband and family, basically, it was just something that we all assumed that it is not possible to continue as a doctor since my vision is dropping.
Right.
So when you told me that information, it was suddenly like a new option, a new choice opened to me. And then I started slowly, kind of harboring that possibility and that dream in me somewhere. Then you put me in touch with another doctor friend of ours,
You're talking about the doctor in Bangalore, the psychiatrist.
Yes, the psychiatrist. And I thought that, like, it was so amazing and inspiring to talk to him, that in spite of his low vision, he is fully functional clinically.
He does everything. That's right.
Which a sighted person does.
Yeah.
And then to me, it was like, I mean, if he can do it, why not me? Yeah, it is a little late in my life, probably to make a change or whatever. But then I was so driven by that dream and that possibility that I finally approached him. I spoke to him. He was very encouraging. He, in fact, found an opportunity and a course for me in CMC Vellore,
right,
which I could do. And then I enrolled into the course. The teachers and the staff in CMC Vellore were extremely supportive.
You went to Vellore?
They are still supportive. Yes,
you went to Vellore. Okay.
Yes. I went to Vellore for the program.
Yes.
It was over a period of 1 year.
Right.
And the staff and the teachers there were so supportive. They are still supportive. In fact, like, even today, if I have a difficult case, I reach out to them and they respond.
Right.
Immediately.
Right.
So, I mean, it was such a humbling experience. Like, that was an area where I was not made to feel like a lesser doctor or a lesser human being ever.
Right.
And then I suddenly thought that probably it was my calling for, people who go through any chronic disease, not
yes.
just blindness, any chronic disease, there are a lot of mental issues involved. There is a lot of depression and anxiety involved.
Yes.
With any disease. And I thought probably it's my calling because I have gone through that myself.
Right.
Maybe I could do a little bit to kind of treat and alleviate the kind of mental turmoil anybody with a disease or chronic pain suffers from.
Right.
So, and I think that is my calling and that is my passion today. So that is how the
transition.
Shift from the transition from ophthalmology to mental health happened.
And so once you qualified to be a mental health professional, did you work with somebody else to kind of gain some kind of hands-on experience, or you
yes.
started your own setup?
So I worked after completing the course. I completed the course in 2019.
Right.
After that, for around 6 months, I worked with a doctor here in Hyderabad.
Yes.
And again, the psychiatrist in Bangalore, Nimhans, our friend, he was so kind that he arranged for a visit to Nimhans. So
yes.
that I could go and learn at the premier institute for mental health in this country.
Right.
Unfortunately, it was scheduled for March, April and 2020. Yeah. And that is when COVID happened. But I'm really hopeful that once the situation is better, I would go to Nimhans. That's another dream of mine,
right.
that I would be able to go to Nimhans and probably do an observership with the best of the psychiatrists in this country.
So, but you still have a kind of a psychiatric practice or a mental health
yes,
practice
yes,
going on right
yes,
now in
yes,
Hyderabad.
Absolutely, absolutely. So I have started a psychiatry practice here in a hospital in Hyderabad.
Yeah.
And I am getting very good response and reviews. And again, maybe because I feel that I feel that maybe it was my calling. That is why I feel that, and it's almost like a new chance to me. So I really want to do it justice to the chance that has been given to me again to get into clinical practice. So I'm really passionate about it, and I really want to do it justice to my patients who come to me. And yeah, I mean, it's COVID times, and there is a lot of mental health issues happening around. So probably it's the need of the hour too.
Yeah, I believe so, because COVID is going to throw up a lot of mental health issues. A lot of people into depression. People have lost their jobs. People have been, have to seriously change the course of their lives. So yes. I think professionals like you would be much in demand.
Yes, and that is the that was the vision of CMC Vellore actually. So they are training doctors, MBBS doctors, to become mental health professionals because they feel that the need of psychiatrists is so high in this country. There are very few psychiatrists in the country, and the ones who get trained well, like from AIIMS, NIMHANS, and CMC Vellore, most of them go out of the country. Because they get better paid in US or Australia or Canada. They leave the country. The few who stay back in India are so overloaded with work. They are probably not able to do justice. Like if you're seeing like 100 patients a day, you're not able to do justice to all of them. So the idea and the vision of CMC Vellore is to have more mental health professionals, more MBBS doctors trained in psychiatry who can do justice to the amount of mental health load this country has. So,
in fact, this is not really true of only mental health. Mental health probably is more acute. But yes. I think, generally speaking, I think we have fewer doctors than are needed. We need many more, actually.
Absolutely. So and the COVID situation has made it more evident than ever.
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. I have, retinitis pigmentosa is often seen as a genetic disorder. Do you have people in your family who've got retinitis pigmentosa?
No, absolutely not. So, not just this generation, but I think at least 3-4 generations before also, we don't have anybody in the family who has had retinitis pigmentosa. And probably that is why when it was detected almost 12 years back, it was a shock to me. I was an ophthalmologist myself, and it was just by chance. And I had 6-6 vision in both the eyes. I was doing surgeries. I was doing my OPD practice, and it was just by chance that it was picked up. And probably it was picked up because I was in the clinic myself.
Right.
So otherwise, it would not have been picked up till much later. And when it was picked up, it was such a shock to me that I didn't know what hit me, kind of.
Right. I can imagine.
Yeah. And then from there on, everything in my life, every decision that I would make, would just have this color of retinitis pigmentosa over it, this filter with which I started viewing life, career, marriage, wanting to have kid, what if the kid also has it?
Yeah.
Things like that. So every decision in my life would be about what if.
Yeah, I just wanted to check here, Meghna, that you obviously was diagnosed with retinitis pigmentosa once you were married.
Yes.
And I believe you also are married to a doctor.
Yes.
And you stay with your in-laws and so on, right?
Not in the same house, but close by.
So how did this affect the family dynamics, and how did people in the family kind of respond to you, and how did you deal with it?
So I still feel that till date, probably my family just does not know how to deal with it. Like they don't know how to respond to it. There are times when they are overprotective, like, no, you cannot travel alone. You should not travel alone. There are times when they are just probably they don't understand that I would probably need some things or. For example, if they make plans to go out, like some trekking or some expedition outside, it is kind of assumed that I'll not be taken along. So it's like kind of assumed, okay, fine. I mean, since you have a disability, it's fine. You stay home. So,
how about your husband? Meaning, what's his response to all this?
It's the same. It's the same. Okay. It keeps on, oscillating between being overprotective to being not understanding. So also when my son was born, he's 6 years now.
Yeah.
So when he was born initially, like my mother, my own mother would not let me give him a bath.
Oh, okay.
She'd be like, oh, what if, you drop him or you drown him or he slips from your grip or whatever.
Right.
So I think good intentions, but somewhere it was, for every small thing, I had to kind of prove myself.
Yeah.
I can travel alone. And I did start traveling alone. I can give a bath to my own son.
Yeah.
I can feed him. I can sit with him and I can, get his homework done and studies done. So for everything, my family would kind of assume that I'm incapable of doing it. So it would start from there. And then I have to prove it's that, I can go out with you guys on a trek expedition. To everything, it starts from there. So
right.
I feel that a lot of disappointment and disillusionment also happens because of that. That probably the assumption, again, like I told you, a weakness, a lesser, a less capable person, kind of these things automatically crop up. Even for that matter, when I made the transition to psychiatry, I was discouraged. I was said that is it even allowed? And then I told them that yes, 60% is the disability criteria, and I fit into that.
Yeah.
So it's not as if you have a visual disability, you cannot be a doctor at all.
Yeah.
There are criterias and I fit into those criterias and I can very well go ahead. And there is somebody who has a visual disability and who is working in the Apex Institute of this country. He's very well accepted and he's doing extremely well. If that example would not have been there in front of them, I'm sure I would not have been encouraged to make the transition at all.
Another question which comes from what you just said, you have transitioned from being an ophthalmologist to being a psychiatrist,
yes,
or a mental health,
yes,
professional through your your fresh courses that you did, the training,
yes,
that you undertook in Vellore and so on. But to operate as a visually impaired person, did you have to pick up any additional skills?
Yes. So I still have to pick up a lot of skills. I know you also keep on encouraging me to do that. But yes, the major transition that I have made is that now I rely more on voiceover and voice messaging or reading texts in voiceover rather than reading it visually. And trust me, it's much more, in fact, it's much more efficient than a lot of sighted people do it.
Yeah, and you're talking about, you use voiceover on an iPhone and you use,
yes,
you use NVIDIA or JAWS on your laptop or computer.
Yes,
okay.
Yes. And the psychiatrist friend of mine had told me that, in fact, in NIMHANS, he's the person who is made to, in fact, he's given the maximum work to write the notes or take the take down notes during rounds and all that, because his speed is the maximum.
Right.
Compared to even sighted people, even sighted doctors, his speed is so fast. His typing speed is like 90 words per minute and things,
wow,
like that. So yeah. So in fact, I feel that sometimes these skills actually make you more efficient. It's just that we feel that these are the skills which are meant only for the visually disabled.
And so, when patients meet you face to face, meaning, do you see any kind of strange responses?
Again, I find that, in fact, it's So a couple of patients ask me that, so when I'm walking slowly, a couple of patients do ask me that, have you hurt yourself in the leg or something?
Right.
Then I tell them, no, actually I have low vision. And I think, yeah, I mean, and in fact, a lot of patients with mental illnesses like anxiety and depression, when I, if appropriate and if in the context, if I give them my example and of the choices that I made and the transition that I made, I think a lot of people actually find it very comforting and so.
It's inspiring. An asset. It's an asset that you have. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So I think especially a lot of people find it acting from a position of therapist.
Yes.
People find it as an asset or a real life qualification rather than just a degree or anything. So I actually find it as an asset now.
So you have a degree and you also have a life experience to share.
Absolutely. Yeah. And then it looks more genuine, in fact, because you have gone through it yourself and you say that, you know, I went through anxiety, depression myself, and this is how I came out of it. People find it more genuine compared to somebody just reading out of the textbook or prescribing medicines.
So one more question, you live in an environment, or I'm talking about your family environment, where people are kind of overprotective, people are kind of all the time waiting to do something for you, and then and keeping you out of activities which they think that would be harmful to you.
Yes.
So how do you keep your spirits up? Do you have any social support network or something that you tap into on a regular basis?
Absolutely. So you and Dr. Sharad, they put me in touch with a couple of visually impaired people in Hyderabad.
Right.
And they are all people who are professionally and personally very successful people.
Right.
So they are also people I look up to. So,
right.
Over a period of time, we formed a circle, we meet each other, at least before COVID, we used to meet regularly also.
Right.
So, we call up each other, and it's a group that stands up for me, I feel. So, whenever I have, any issues, I just bounce it off them. And I know that they will understand, or
right,
they have overcome that themselves. So whatever comes from them is like completely, they understand and they are completely empathetic. So
excellent.
Like I told you, like my family was not really in favor of me making the transition to psychiatry. And just telling them that, Dr. Sharad is there and he is one of the successful people in NIMHANS, and that was enough for them to get convinced. I think a lot of sighted people or the family and friends of somebody who's going through disease actually don't know.
Right.
Like they don't know. They don't know how to react, how to handhold, how to support. I think it's just comes naturally to them to be, you know, to be overprotective and say, ki, better not do, right? I mean, why put yourself through that trouble of going out and doing something?
Right.
So, and I think most of my friends, like at least in Hyderabad, the circle that I was talking about, they also went through similar things when their blindness started off.
Right.
I think it's very natural for some of the families to be overprotective.
What is your son? What is your son? He's 6 now, so you must be having interesting responses from him.
Yes. So I remember maybe a year back, or maybe even earlier than that, maybe he was 4, and then he was like, "Mama, aapko kyun nahi dikhta hai?" So I was like, "Ki beta, mujhe ek disease ho gaya hai, jiski wajah se mujhe nahi dikhta hai." बाकियों की मम्मा को भी नहीं दिखता है क्या? I was like, नहीं बेटा, बाकियों की मम्मा को दिखता है, आपकी मम्मा स्पेशल है. So I think, or there are times, again, somewhere much younger, like I was walking around the house and I hit myself by the corner of the table.
Yeah.
So like I kind of, and it really hurt. And he was just sitting there and watching. And then after that, when I moved out, he was just hitting the corner. Like, the table. He was like, you hit
punishing,
my mom.
Punishing the corner.
Punishing the table corner. So, yeah, there are times. But there are times when he again assumes, अरे मम्मा आपको नहीं दिखेगा आप रहने दो. But then, yeah, he helps me with gardening. Like, just today morning, he was like, मम्मा यहाँ पे ये सब ये leaves, मतलब ये पूरे सूख गए हैं. So, he'll point out कि इसमें रोज आ गया है आप देख लो यहाँ पे वाइट रोज आया है यहाँ रेड रोज आया है यहाँ पे ये प्रॉब्लम्स है तो आप कट कर दो ये लीव्स. सो ही गाइड्स मी लाइक ही नोज कि हियर शी विल रिक्वायर सम प्रॉम्प्ट्स एंड हेल्प एंड हियर इट इज बेटर टू टेल हर कि ओके लेट इट बी. सो
नो चिल्ड्रन आर ब्यूटीफुल एक्चुअली दे ऑर्गेनिकली रिस्पोंड टू यू यू नो.
यस
सो दैट्स ब्यूटीफुल.
Yes.
And so, outside your professional and your family life, what are your passions? What are the things that make you happy? What are the things that you were doing before you continue to do? And there must be things that you were doing before, yes, but you are not able to now.
Yes.
Could you share some of them?
Yeah. So I think I always loved reading books and, again, there was a transition period where maybe because of my low phase in life, the depression, I kind of was not reading at all.
Yeah.
So from being a complete bibliophile to somehow I would not pick up, or if I would pick up, I would not finish a book. And from there till and to today, I actually run book clubs. So in my own society, I kind of other enthusiastic book readers, I have formed a group and kind of initiate those discussions. And we have a very lively group around books.
Right.
So I think the switch again to audiobooks really helped.
Right.
And I love audiobooks, actually. I think, again, we think, matlab, earlier maybe I used to think of it as a disadvantage, but it's actually an advantage because when you're listening to audiobooks, you can just keep on doing whatever like household chores you're doing and you can still finish a book. Whereas when you're reading a physical copy, you need to assign that time to that, to reading.
Right.
Yeah. So I think I quite enjoy the audiobooks because of the style of dialogue delivery or the music which is incorporated into it. So I'm completely enjoying audiobooks nowadays.
So you read books from Audible, is it?
Yes, I read books from Audible. Yes. Okay. And I remember you had suggested Storytel. And yeah, again, a couple of other friends have suggested Storytel. I'm going to try it for sure. And also there are a lot of audiobooks on YouTube. So I kind of try and find stuff on YouTube as well. So, yeah.
Who are some of the authors you love reading?
Yes, I find quite a few of them, at least the famous ones on YouTube for free.
Right.
So, yeah.
Who are some of the authors you enjoy reading?
So there's this whole range of from fiction, like Harry Potter series, because I kind of, you know, in my formative years, I had Harry Potter with me, to nonfiction, Malcolm Gladwell in nonfiction,
yeah,
Outliers, Blink.
Yeah.
The latest author I really enjoyed was Yuval Noah Harari. So
Sapiens. Yeah, that's a nice
21
book.
Lessons from 21st Century, and like amazing author, amazing. So
right.
Yeah, so entire range of fiction to nonfiction. Plus in our book club, every month we decide a book from different genres.
Yeah.
So
there was this book called A Man Called Ove.
Yeah.
It's a very heartwarming, very nice book. So these are the recent books that I read.
Who's the author of this book, Man Called Ove?
He's a Swedish author. I kind of don't remember the name. But it's a Swedish author, and the story is based out of Sweden, and it's about this lonely man who has just lost his wife,
right,
of more than 50, I think more than some 30 years or something.
Yeah.
And it's about his loneliness and still how he finds happiness and a sense of community amongst the people, amongst his neighbors. And then he actually starts being productive in his community and starts giving back to life. And I think maybe it resonated with me also, because it was very similar to me. I had lost the sense of purpose and lost the sense of kind of belonging to my own family and everything. And over a period of time, I think things changed. And today I do feel a sense of purpose. I do feel that I can stand up for myself. Like, if my family does not understand, or like I said, they are being overprotective, I can stand up for myself and I can be assertive in situations. And instead of being gloomy or sad or hurt about it, I think I kind of make myself heard. So
excellent. Yeah.
Yeah.
So in conclusion, I wanted to ask you, how do you see your future, say, in the next 5 to 10 years? What are your plans? What are your dreams, if any?
Yeah, so I would really, I feel a lot of mental health and also a lot of chronic diseases. It's about this feeling of shame and stigma, a feeling of weakness, and people don't come out and talk about it in open, and they don't seek help. And in my case, help just happened. Like, you came across, and then one step led to another, and it happened. But I never reached out to anybody to seek help. So in spite of support groups, in spite of professionals existing, people just don't reach out. Yeah. And it would be really my dream if I could kind of advocate or create systems or create an organization which could help in doing that. In the area of mental health especially, and in the area of people suffering with chronic diseases. So I think that would be my dream. Also, on a personal front, my dream would be to be able to do everything that I used to do as a sighted person. If it is like, if it is going out in parties and still feeling comfortable among sighted people, or going to travel and being confident that you will be able to navigate the world alone, if there is nobody along with you. So these are still issues which subconsciously I feel at some level I'm still a little scared about. I think if that part can also completely go out of me, that would be really like feeling complete and feeling whole again. So yeah. I think these are the two dreams that I have at a professional and personal stage.
Meghna, wonderful speaking with you. It is your life story is very heartwarming, inspiring, and it's a work in progress, which is a very
absolutely
positive thing, because the moment you think the work is done, that's when you stop growing.
Yes.
So it's fantastic, and it was lovely talking to you. Wish you all the best. And
thank you so much, George. Thank you. As I said, thank you not only for having me here, but thank you for everything that you did for me to make it possible for me to make the transitions and make the right choices in my life.
Excellent. Thank you. Well, it's a pleasure having you on the show. And incidentally, you are my first guest on IVA Conversations.
Oh,
so
I didn't know.
Yeah. So okay. Thank you so much. And
thanks, take George.
Take care.
Thank you so much. Bye. IVA, yeh roshni ka karwa.